Hello and welcome to a very special IGN UK podcast because we're in our new studio.
Hooray!
We built it with our own hands. Well, Dale built it, let's be honest.
Well done, Dale.
Well done, Dale. But it's also special because we're going to run through our favourite video games of 2015. My name is Gav Miffy, this is Dan Krupa.
Hello.
And I'm also joined by Alex Simmons as
So, you never call me Dan.
I know, I don't know why I did it. It feels really
dirty. Dilly always calls me Dan. Nobody ever calls me Dan.
Dan, little Dan.
We've got a Dan. Anyway.
Oh yeah, Kilby.
Have you a happy Dan?
Yeah,
no. You're pretty happy.
I'm all right. Depends.
You alright?
Yeah, I'm alright. Let's just get on with it.
Who wants to kick us off then with a good game that came out in 2015?
You do it, Creeper. Because mine's not technically a game.
Happy
Mine's not. What are you doing?
You'll have to wait.
What a star. What a good star.
It's tortellini. I just love them. Bloodborne. And I feel like the game's been out for quite some time.
Yeah.
So, a few spoilers I'm going to say.
Okay.
Because I want to discuss it properly. Like, you know, it came out a long time ago now.
Yeah.
What an amazing game. And I know it's really boring to hear people drone on about Soulsy games and say why they're good. But it's brilliant. And all that you ever saw of that game before it came out, and it looked like this kind of gothic werewolf game.
Mm.
There's mental stuff in that game. You go to Nightmare Realms, there's aliens, proper Lovecraft stuff.
Yeah.
And the story is so detailed. And the DLC just came out recently. I won't go into specifics about that. But it just connected dots in a really interesting way. And you can like speculate for hours about the story. And like no game this year have I been that engrossed in.
Yeah.
Like, and there's not really... The longest cutscene in the game is 15 seconds.
Right. Awesome.
Every bit of the story comes from inference.
Yeah.
Like looking at bosses and going, like, what happened to this person to make them that messed up?
Yeah.
What's this like house for? Reading item descriptions.
Yeah.
And not item descriptions. You know when you pick up collectibles?
Yeah.
And it's just like pages. And immediately you go, I'm not reading that.
Yeah.
I want to get back to playing it.
Yeah.
These are very short, like two lines.
Yeah.
And because they're so brief and well written, like the translation in these games is really good. You just kind of like stays with you and you go, I wonder what the hell that means. And then something will happen 5 hours later and you're like, this maybe belonged to that person.
Right.
And you have this like,
kind of like
epiphany.
Lore, isn't it?
Yeah, and you have this epiphany. You're going, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Like small little details. Like, this is amazing. I'll just draw it.
For the people listening.
I'm drawing the Bloodborne symbol.
Okay. Yeah.
And this is the Hunter's Mark in Bloodborne.
Okay.
And
so it's like an upside down trident.
Yeah. And I don't know if it's on the cover, but it's, I can't remember the term. It spells, it's got every letter in Bloodborne in it. It's got the B.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
got the L. It's got the O and the D. And it's like stuff like that, really deep.
Yeah, that's
there's
cool.
There's not a U in there. That's because there's not a U in Bloodborne.
No, but it's like little details like that. So everything is incredibly well considered.
Yeah.
And
I really
like, the
wish I'd spend...
been mind blowing as well.
I really wish I spent more time with it. Like,
I still can. And the DLC is brilliant. It's how DLC should be done, I think.
The thing with it is, like, I really loved it. I loved the world, and I loved like everything that was created. The same stuff, but it was just like really frustrating. And there's a bit where I was like, I have mastered this weapon. I've mastered this person. I'm amazing. I've just killed this boss really easily. I'm brilliant at it. And then like an enemy that I was fine with comes up and just kills me really easily, and I'm starting to struggle with that guy then.
Yeah.
Like, the way that it's such an evil game in that way. It's
super challenging.
There's something good about it.
It's like, it's part of its DNA, because I recently interviewed Miyazaki, and I said, do you get really bored, people saying, like, your games are really hard?
Yeah.
Like, it's kind of probably the least interesting thing about
them.
And he's like, no, because that's just part of its DNA. It's one of the reasons why people love them so much, because do want to make them a challenge. And at the end of it, it's just every moment you're like so intensely invested in what's happening.
Yeah.
There's a lot of games, even though you enjoy it, you can go on autopilot.
Yeah.
Like some of the other games on my list, like really big games, you can play and enjoy and you can be on autopilot.
Yeah.
That is like your, it's almost like an arcade.
But even though it's challenging, it's never unfair, which I think is the key thing.
It's down to
your skill as a player.
Like hitboxes on enemies are perfect.
Yeah.
Like if the boss doesn't hit you with its sword or whatever, it's not going to take any energy. It's not it's really finely tuned.
Yeah.
When you interviewed Miyazaki, did you ask him about that time that I saw him outside O'Neill's in Covent Garden?
No.
you didn't? Why?
Well, I just thought it was a bit disrespectful.
I saw him coming out of O'Neill's with one of his mates, and they were having a right old giggle about something. So
do you reckon they did like a burger deal?
Oh yeah, probably yeah.
Maybe
that's what it
a
was.
Beer and a burger for like a fiver or something like that.
It was just after that O'Neill's had just been redesigned as well, so
yeah.
Maybe they were one of the first people.
One time a copy of Dark Souls, and then you opened up the box, and inside was a copy of Lego the Movie Game.
He's like, this is like, wind up. What's this?
Like, in my defense, like, copy of Dark Souls, I think it's probably still in my PS3. That's right. The only reason why I would turn it on.
You're like, am I being punked?
And he's just like, Lego Movie? And I was like, ah, it's not very good, is it?
You're like, what would your take on the Lego Movie game be, Miyazaki?
That's what I really want to know.
Lego Dark Souls would be good.
That would be really good. Al, what was good this year?
Lots of games are good, but probably the thing that I had the most fun with wasn't a full game, but an expansion.
Okay.
GTA Heists, after, what was it, 2 years?
Yeah.
A really, really long time, finally came out. And it's probably the most fun I've had in a multiplayer environment ever. And within games, obvs.
I think we did it really well. We took the studio, if you're watching this video, these tellies behind us, and set them all up so me, Al, Cooper, and Rory could play it all together.
Yeah.
And we're all in the same room, shouting at each other and things like that.
Yeah.
It is really, really good.
Yeah. But also, the thing I like about it, because one of the other games I'm going to talk about later is Rainbow Six Siege, but that is a punishing multiplayer experience.
Horrible,
it's not so much fun. Yeah. It's stressful, whereas this you can dick around and have a laugh, especially playing with Rory is the loosest cannon of anyone I've ever played a game with. But that's what makes it fun.
It's
because
we're racing to the starting point and you just see him in the corner of your eye, just jump, let's take his car and just jump off a cliff.
Yeah.
He's
like,
I'll get there.
And also because his character's got this tiny little pedo tash and just wears this tiny little pair of ball smackers.
Yeah.
And it's like,
So many times in the heist, I got paired with Rory, and there was bits where he had to drive, and I was on a gun, and I was like, "What are you doing?"
Yeah.
I look over at him, and he's just like, "Oh, there's the road," and he's just gone right over here. He's like, "No, no, no, I know what I'm doing," and then it's just like, "You both died."
Yeah,
oh, great.
The van is now on fire.
Yeah,
but it would
Rory's
be
like, "It's fine."
Three of us going in, still, so right, let's go in this way. You snipe from the top, and then you just see him bowl in this massive 4x4 with the horn going and
everything. I feel like this might come up when we talk about Rainbow Six Siege as well.
Yeah.
That's true. But multiplayer on GTA, I'd played a bit before Heist, but never that much because I much prefer playing cooperatively.
Mm.
And, as an experience, that was just brilliant. And it was free.
Yeah.
The mission that... It's bonkers. The brilliant mission where a couple of us had to go into the prison.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what was the other team doing?
You were stealing the plane, and Rory was protecting you with the chopper.
Yeah, yeah,
and then
yeah.
And
yeah.
You were going to prison. Yeah. And we brought that guy out, and that was the moment where everything came together in this brilliantly dynamic way.
Yeah.
None of it's scripted, and you and I are driving this dude in an armored truck
to
a landing strip where you were trying to land the plane.
Yeah.
Rory's shooting all these cops that were coming.
Yeah.
I'm driving this car towards you. I see you coming down, and I'm like, I'm going to crash into you. So I swerve around the back of you. And as I turn around, chaos is happening everywhere.
Yeah.
We get him in.
We're running out of the van. We're running out of the van.
Get into the plane, and then we all parachute. It's it just looks incredible.
Because that's the thing, it's
that's one of my gaming moments of 2015.
Yeah. Completely
we were all like, it's good.
But it's other games would do that, but you would literally have no control. Or
it would look the same every time.
Through, but this was completely unscripted.
It's really smart.
Yeah, completely staggering.
There was a really amazing bit where we're all jumping out in the parachutes, and we'd oh, it's ending. We all just chatting and stuff like that. And I was so close to not pulling my parachutes. I was just you were like, "What are you doing?" And I was like, "I don't know."
Try more.
Yeah. I know.
No, that was
really
good.
But I would love for more of those to come out at some point because. Yeah, that kind of focus. And I love all the other bits that have since come out.
Mm.
All of the kind of random events. And
some Halloween stuff is good.
Halloween stuff
with that.
Yeah.
We play that stalker. We're in the meat factory at night. It's fun stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But having that level of, the kind of multi-tiered mission.
Yeah.
And, sticking through it all the way out.
Yeah.
It's God, love it. Absolutely love it.
One of my favorite games that we played, and is a game that we all had to go at together as well, is Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes.
Now... It's kind of a weird game to kind of understand. So, do you want to try and describe it?
Yeah, yeah. It's basically it's two players. One of you, you're basically the idea is you're defusing a bomb. One of you has the plans on PDF or like whatever.
Paper plans, actual plans to how to do it.
The other person has the bomb in front of them, but the person who has the bomb can't see the plans. The person who has the plans can't see the bomb. So you literally, you have to like talk and communicate, and the person with the plans has to tell you how to defuse the bomb, what to click, what to press, what buttons to do. And they're all puzzles. So like the bomb might have like four different puzzles on it. So we've got to be like, oh, there's the button puzzle or like the Simon Says puzzle and stuff like that. Like, so you develop this like weird, like we played it for a good, what, like 5 hours maybe?
And we stayed late one night. Yeah. We stayed so late that people didn't know we were in the studio and they locked up the office.
Yeah.
And we came out and set off the alarm.
So
when we finished, like, oh, we should go home. It's like 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
And I was like, we just opened the studio door. It's like, oh no, it's dark. And the alarm's on.
Right.
And we were like, do we step out of the studio?
It's like, it's not in the plans.
we set off. We had to like wait.
Yeah. It was.
Did you not have the fob to disarm
the alarm?
You should have read the manual, man.
Yeah, once you trigger the motion sensor, it all went crazy.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah, they couldn't disable it.
But it's a brilliant game. I'm not even sure how much it is, but it's
good. I should say, like, the puzzles, like, the paper bit, some of them are really,
really
complex.
They're bastards,
It's really difficult, and they screw you over because, like, for instance, they make it hard to communicate certain bits of information clearly.
Yeah.
So one of them is like words, but it's like you are.
Yeah.
So it's very hard to communicate exact info. It's
Really like the hieroglyphics and
a Venn diagram and wire cutting is ridiculous. Yeah. Morse code.
Yeah.
What was impossible.
What was interesting is after we had played it, we had our own little. We had our lingo down for the hieroglyphics, and then we filmed the video, we haven't put it up yet, where everyone else came in, and it was interesting to see what other people were calling it. Like, I tried playing it with Dale, and I was like, Half-Life symbol, and he was just like, what? And then he was just like, it's like an A with a leg. Like, what are you talking about? but it is really good. Yeah, Luke and Rory playing it together was just amazing, because I was like a proper married couple going at it.
Yeah.
That was
also
fantastic.
The communication between the pair of them was just like
non-existent. Yeah.
I don't think they did one puzzle. But
there was like wires, but there is horizontal and vertical wires, but they didn't specify that.
Oh, it's hard to watch.
Still to this day,
swore that he said it. He didn't.
But we'll stick that video up at some point because it's really, really good.
Yeah.
But another one that's on, I think, all of our list is Rocket League.
Yeah. Yep. I think it's safe to say that this year, if you look at all of the kind of sports games that came out, FIFA was as good as it's always been in the last couple of years. Finally, PES made the kind of comeback that we've been wanting. PES was brilliant this year. But unfortunately, it came out the same year as Rocket League, which absolutely is the best sports game of 2015.
It captured so many people's imagination. I remember hearing about it for the first time at E3.
Yeah.
And people were saying, you know, pitching it what it is. Even though there was a game before it.
I can't
remember, what was it originally called? But it's like a remake of it.
Yeah.
People like Rocket Football, like Rocket Car Football,
or
soccer, they'd be saying in the US office.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, that is something they've literally done on Top Gear. And it's like, is it? And it came out and it was free on PS Plus.
Well, I think that was really the masterstroke.
Because you got a huge install base immediately.
Yeah.
And it just became a phenomenon. I think it's true to say it was a phenomenon. Like,
yeah,
people
definitely,
were like,
it was a thing.
It was a thing for quite a good amount of time as well.
I organised like a night, a tournament, like a loading bar in Dalston. Like, I organised an actual tournament with like industry people came along and like played it and stuff. Like, people from Ubisoft ended up winning it.
Well, you say Ubisoft, they knocked us out. Didn't they?
Yeah. But, did they knock
Square Enix
IG out?
Square Enix won it.
Oh, yeah, they did, yeah. But they were really good anyway. But that's the thing, it became a thing. Like, I was in that night, because I was hosting it, so I was trying to do like commentary and stuff. But people were watching it like it was a real sport.
Yeah, it was brilliant. I'm not massively into esports just because I haven't got into it and I don't really play many of the games that esports hinge on.
Yeah.
And we had a big projector on that night in spectator mode. So basically looks like a game of football.
Yeah.
Loving watching it. Like, this is such an exciting game to watch.
Yeah.
Like, well, the last ditch saves, like crazy goals.
Well, I think that's part of its beauty is that it's incredibly simple.
Yeah.
And anyone can pick up and play straight a bit. But like, when I remember you first showed me like a video of someone like kind of flying through the sky and then knocking in a goal from halfway out, I was like, oh my God, that is kind of some next level stuff.
Yeah.
I'm still nowhere near that.
It is simple.
Yeah.
But there's like, there's a knack. Like, it's really hard to like, like, initially you're like, I can't hit it.
Yeah.
It's not going exactly what, and then you learn little tricks like swerving and how to,
and like flipping,
you still miss it, but you still miss it occasionally. Cause it's,
but you do have those games where everything that you do is exactly right and it just goes into the corner of the net, and then you have those other games where
you
rock it past and miss the ball and it goes in your own net, which we've all had.
The thing that's really good about it as well is all the DLC and stuff that's come out, it's all sort of skin stuff. It doesn't change the car. The car that everyone has is exactly the same, so it doesn't change like how skilled your car is or anything like that, which I think is a really, really clever thing.
I read
thing.
That there's different hitboxes for some of the cars.
Well, I think that's true in terms, because some of them are bigger. So I spent a ridiculous amount of time watching someone just driving up to the ball in the centre circle and then how it would differ.
Right.
So if you've got a low car, it's actually getting underneath the ball more, so it would be a higher lob. Whereas if it's kind of the bigger van, it would knock it low and... So if you had a smaller car, if you hit it, you know, at the beginning, you'd hit the top of the bar and it would come back out. Whereas if you had the van, the lower projector would mean it would go in if there was no goalkeeper.
Well, what I think is awesome about it and what I think is a really good sports game, it's a really good representation of what it's like to play football.
Mm.
Because if you play FIFA, you know, minus rocket cars and the wizard hats, that's, you know... Bear with me on this one.
Yeah.
Is if you play FIFA or PES, there's loads of assists going on and you're going from player to player. Yeah. This, like, you have to think about anticipating where the ball's going to go.
Yeah.
Being the play goalkeeper. Proper football. That's what it's about. It's being positioned.
It's really stressful.
Being disciplined. Yeah. Like, sometimes going, I have to defend right now. Yeah. It's not glamorous, but I'll stay in defence. Otherwise, we'll get thumped.
Yeah.
And also anticipating where the ball's going to go. Because if everyone just chases towards the ball.
Yeah.
You'll do terribly.
Like we did all right. We had a kind of a bit of a rush goalie system in place. Yeah. So like someone would always make sure they're back to cover.
Yeah.
But like being the keeper is nails.
Especially again, like we mentioned it before, but playing with Rory as well is bonkers because like we came back, we went to the pub one Friday night, and then me, Rich, Rory, and my girlfriend came back to the office. We thought, we'll just play Rocket League. And like the amount of times that Rory just seen Mad Max as well. So he's just shouting, witness me! See, it's like bombing through on the ball. Yeah.
Running through.
But the thing about it, it's perfect game for him.
Yeah.
just driving up walls.
But similarly, he would have moments of like absolute inspiration and then moments of sheer madness.
Yeah. But that's good.
What a game.
Yeah.
Another one, like game that I really enjoyed playing actually, and we did quite a fun video on it, was Titan Souls. Which, like, when I first played this at E3, like maybe like a year or two ago, it's basically like 1 hour, you're a knight, you have one arrow, if you get hit once, you die.
Yeah.
And it's all boss battles. And it's just brilliant. It's like really well designed, like the music's brilliant, like the design on the bosses, like you have to figure out the thing. They've all got one thing. Like,
weakness,
It's hard when it doesn't... After you've worked out that thing, it also doesn't mean that then you've mastered that either. Like, because some of them are still, like, just really so hard.
Yeah.
Like, the ice one. Like, even though you've worked out exactly how to do it, it's still really hard to do.
Yeah.
Which I think is really, really good. Because, like one of those things where it could have been rubbish to play again because you're like, well, I've worked out the thing, it's absolutely fine.
Yeah.
But it's hard because you're
even
just
if you know
like,
doing it is a different thing.
Exactly,
it?
Yeah. It's like, and it's hard having like those puzzles as well because like they don't give you anything. You walk into the room, it's like, right, what is going on? And like if you look at the video of me and Rory playing it, we're just like, what am I meant to do?
Yeah. And even when, it's like ones where I just can't shoot it. There's one that I hate it. It's like, imagine if you're on a big chessboard and the boss is a cube. And he's like, he's turning on like his sides and he has like a weak spot on one of the sides. But getting in a position where you can fire it at
solid,
him is so difficult.
Yeah.
Because he moves so fast because he covers so much ground when he turns.
Yeah. It's a good game to play as well, like on a sofa with someone. And like just to pass the pad.
Yeah.
Like, which you barely get like those good games like that anymore.
Yeah.
And that's why it's in my top five. What have you got, Krupa?
So I'm going to go to my second game, which is Her Story.
Ooh.
It's on PC, Mac, and iOS devices. And it is from a guy called Sam Barlow, a British guy, who works on Silent Hill Shattered Memories.
Mm.
And this is his pitch on the website. True Detective via Blair Witch.
Nice.
Well, what doesn't sound good about
that?
So the premise is you're at a computer... which is a data bank of all the kind of police files and I can't remember where it is, like say Brighton, somewhere like that.
Yeah.
And you can access them by searching for certain keywords.
Okay.
And what you're watching is a woman, think she's called Viva Safet.
Yeah.
And she's like giving, she's been interviewed by the police. And so it starts off, you see a snippet of the interview. And then based on what she says in that interview, you can search, basically Googling,
yeah.
and you'll bring up more files to watch. Right. So if she says something, I'm not going to go into spoilers because this is a game that would be really ruined by anything yeah. like that. If she says, like, I don't know, a date,
yeah,
like February 12th,
yeah,
after like when I was watching her like interviews, I would like write certain things down. Right, then you go right. February 12th, yeah. and then you might get five videos, and you're like, oh god, right, I'll watch all these,
yeah,
and then after each one of them, you're like, right, well, who's that dude? Yeah. And you're like writing names down, and go, right, he was the landlord,
yeah,
he's married to this person. I played it with my girlfriend, and we had this like. system, and it felt like a detective. That yeah, great yeah. scene where you always like, I love those scenes in like detective or thriller movies when they have a big board
and it's all
like the wire
and like, yeah, yeah, and like yeah. pictures. And we had yeah. that kind of like in this Moleskine diary, it was like drawing little work, yeah. Like, right, so if they were there on that day, where would that place her? And then you would like be searching for clues, and right. it's so good because you know, he said, Sam Barlow, the developer, said, if you can Google, you can play her story, and that's the main mechanic.
That's amazing.
The main mechanic is basically Googling stuff,
yeah.
which I've never had that before. Yeah. And yeah. it's using, I should say, because I haven't said it if you don't know, the video footage is actually a real actress.
Yeah.
Right? And her performance is really good.
She's just won a bunch of awards, yeah.
Yeah, and it's also like something you used to, when I was younger, you'd have like live action in games.
Like,
yeah,
some kind of like cinematic yeah. FMV stuff.
And that kind of went away. And this uses it in such a clever way.
Yeah.
Well, that's it. Back in the day, it was kind of like, you know, you press right and then maybe your ship would fly right or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Yeah.
I still haven't played her story. I've got it. Like, I'm going to play it by the end of the year, definitely.
Brilliant. You can do it in about 2-3 hours. Like, yeah. I did it in one thing and it's fantastic. You know, if you like stuff like Serial as well yeah. and things yeah, like yeah, that. Yeah.
I like this idea that, like, people are doing interesting things like that because, like, there's a lot of, like, arguments with a lot of, like, bell ends, let's be honest. Like what is a game?
Tell us what you think, Gav.
Yeah, like, well, people saying, like, what is a game, what isn't a game? Like, one of the, I put it on our Skype the other day, one of the best things I've played this year, and I have to write it down because it's such a bonkers title, but it's Dr. Langoskov, the Tiger and the Terribly Cursed Emerald, a Whirlwind Heist. That game probably lasts
so
about...
so quickly, I still don't know what
it's
called.
Yeah, it's fine. You'll never remember it, I don't. But it's like 15 minutes long. But it's brilliant. It's one of the coolest like game experiences I've had this year.
I think you've got to say interactive entertainment. That's like the loosest sense, because otherwise you're just going to go mad.
Because people are like, you know, like, a lot of these games is kind of like you walk around, you explore. So lots of people are like, it's not a game. You're not. But it is. Like, I just love
absolutely.
All these. Like,
yeah.
It's a medium where you can literally do anything you want, pretty much.
Like, everybody's gone to the Rapture.
Yeah,
well,
exactly.
Like,
yeah.
Those kind of games are exploring. That's another great game. I'm putting in my top five because I haven't finished it. But that's a really cool game as well.
Al, what have you got next for us?
I'll stick with something more traditional, I think.
Okay.
I'll go with Rainbow Six Siege, which came out very, very recently. Mm. But the reason I loved it is because loads of shooters loads of games full stop, just handhold all the way through, whereas this game absolutely does not.
Have we even done...
had any success?
No.
Well...
we are playing on hard, which I don't understand.
Yeah, but like, try it in realistic then, where they've got a new mode coming out, which strips off all the HUD, all of the aiming reticules, all of that kind of stuff. But that is the point of the game. The reason we are so absolutely shite is because our comms aren't very good.
Our comms are all over the place.
And I've had more success with smaller groups where you don't kind of get in each other's firing lines.
Are you still talking about the game or work?
just in general, yeah. But like when there's five of us all bowling in through the same door, inevitably someone else is going to step in front of someone. And it's
really hard because
it goes to pot when
when
shit goes down, we lose it.
Let's say we're all thinking when Gav's on the team. That's what we're all thinking.
No, but the ones that we just lose it when we're under attack. It's just all like, instead of like going, I'm literally just going to watch this one, I'll trust you to have my back.
Yes.
I'm doing it as well. I'm turning around.
Yeah.
I'm not trusting you.
Yeah.
We talked about this, like, because there was a point where like me and Dale were coming through and I was like, right, Dale, I'm going to go front. You definitely watch our backs. And he's like, yeah, absolutely fine. So in my head, I'm moving. Dale is like crouching back, but pointing back.
Backtracking.
And then we got shot from behind. I was like, what were you doing? He was like, oh, I was facing forward. It's like, no.
Like, that's the thing. I think it's like how you play that game. Like, every game is like, kill everything.
Yeah.
But you know, you have to like be part of the team. Yeah, it's like something that means that you just watching behind.
Yeah.
Or one of us like me checking for the bombs. That's my goal. I'll stand in the middle of all of you. You protect me.
Yeah.
I'll tell you where stuff is.
That was a thing that I was doing the other day. You know, when we had to protect the hostage.
Yeah.
Like I was watching one door, and I was making sure I was like barricading up and putting traps down and things like that. But then they were all coming from over there.
Yeah.
So you feel super useless because you're just like, but you're like, you got away. And then what ended up happening was they came through that door there.
Yeah. That's why it's a good multiplayer. It's like Rocket League. Like you have to have a bit of dedication to your role and the team rather than just wanting to get stuck in.
Well, that's all the different operators and like learning. There's a lot of hidden depth to
there
that
is,
game.
Like,
well, that's I think that's one of the sort of failings of it as well, really, is that you have to unlock those things. You don't have, it's just, you're just recruit and then you have to play enough that you unlock
those things.
I don't
mind that. Like, I didn't feel that the recruit was so underpowered that he was useless. Like,
no.
I guess he's got
like the drone and all the different things like that.
Yeah, and inevitably, I end up using all of the kind of other operators I've got, a bit like the recruit, which is my own shortcoming.
I think that's the thing. Yeah. Like, we each need to like master a few and really know like them well.
Yeah.
And I don't know that at all
no.
at the moment.
No.
Again, you're getting lured in like, I want to be an attacker. I want to be that guy.
Yeah,
it's like, actually, our team does not need this dude.
No.
We need this like doctor.
People dropping down like health, and
we need someone who has more EMP
like
stuff.
Well, the girly you had the other day, there was like that had like that thing that could check where everything was, and then because actually we were doing quite well then because you then had the EMP.
That's the best we did actually
to take it all down.
That was the best we did because it was proper communication. Like I said, there's loads through there, and you're like, okay, I'll throw my EMP in. We were just a bit slow.
But I think, the other problem with it is that it all goes to shit so quickly. Like you can be doing so well, and then all it takes, it's because they react in different ways. If they hear you coming in from a certain way, they will like funnel in and try and prevent you. They don't just stick to that position,
which is smart as well. Because I think we did a really good thing where we blew. In completely separate parts of the house, blew the windows exactly the same time. And then the people were scattering then. They didn't really know what to do.
Yeah, they're not all going to come
exactly,
to one place.
Because
then you just got bunching two teams and it's just a straight firefight. That's not fighting smart.
Yeah.
Also, I know this is not an awards show, but biggest bell-end enemy of the year, the bomb guys.
Oh,
like,
Yeah, they are the worst.
Horrible.
Especially because like they climb out of like
just what
like
they're doing.
And then when you see them switch it on, then start pegging it towards you, like
blue and red light, like a police car. I'm a police car coming.
The thing that I really another like Rory story as well is watching Rory put a breach charge on the ceiling. Jump and then press the breach. I was like, what? And then Diane's. And he was like, oh, I thought that would work. What about that did you think would work?
Well, that was Dale was the kind of the health dude.
Yeah.
And I was kind of bleeding out.
Mm.
And so he was like, right, I'll zap you with my kind of long distance health injection, whatever
Excellent.
It's called. I don't know.
Yeah.
But instead, he used his shotgun. So he killed me. Just like, oh, well.
That's
I don't
really
think
good.
That's going to make me feel any better.
Another Rory story. We're playing with him. We went to the roof of an embassy, and he was just like going off. I was like, Rory, wait, let's like scan what's in it. He's like, no, it'll be fine. He started abseiling down this like window thing. It was like a spiral staircase.
Right.
So he just went past everyone on every floor, and all I heard was like, what?
Every game is more fun with Rory.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. Right, what's next on your list, Krupa?
Gonna go for a biggie.
All right,
Rise of the Tomb Raider.
I really want to play this game, man. But
lots of people do.
Fucking Xbox One.
Lots of people do. So Xbox One exclusive. We found that out last year. Coming to PS4 probably a year later. It's really good.
Yeah,
it's really good. Like I liked the last Tomb Raider game.
Yeah,
it's a hard thing to do to reboot that franchise. But I thought this one was even better.
Mm.
It did everything I wanted. You know, it looks amazing for one. Like, it's beautiful.
Yeah.
Like, the first mission in the game, you're like climbing what looks like Everest.
Yeah.
Mm.
And it looks fantastic. But the best thing about it isn't when it's doing the kind of the Uncharted spectacle.
Yeah.
Because I think, you know, what we've seen of Uncharted 4, just that motorbike sequence is insane. There's nothing that gets close to that in
it looks
Tomb
incredible.
Raider.
Yeah.
But Rise of the Tomb Raider is the best when it's Tomb Raider.
Yeah.
And there's some brilliant puzzles. Brilliant environmental puzzle solving, like real three-dimensional stuff.
Yeah,
in really great creepy locations.
Yeah,
the DLC stuff that we saw the other day—that looks really
seen that
good.
Trailer?
No,
the DLC that's coming out in January called
Baba Yaga,
Legend of Baba Yaga.
Yeah,
it's like standalone, And I think it's a bit like Undead Nightmare. Like she goes into a place, I think it might be Eastern Europe, and she inhales loads of neurotoxin or hallucinogenics. It's a little bit like Scarecrow missions. And that's the rest of the game,
quite
it looks like one big
Far Cry 3-ish as well. Like drugs.
It's like one big Scarecrow mission, and like she's been pursued in this forest, and there's this bit where she walks down this kind of narrow passageway. And there's lots of skulls, like skeletons. As you walk in, they're very subtly turning towards you.
Right.
It looks really cool.
It does look really, really good.
Sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, so it's one of those big blockbusters that really delivered.
Is it worth buying an Xbox One for?
It's coming out on other platforms.
I know, but not for ages.
I don't think any game really is worth buying a £300 console for. Alone.
Zelda. Not if you get Rocket League for free, though.
Like, if you haven't got a next-gen console and you like Tomb Raider, obviously that could help swing it, but nothing's worth that.
Well, good.
Zelda.
Well, yeah, so obviously you mentioned Rise of the Tomb Raider, but I actually think that Lara Croft Go was perhaps Ms. Croft's best outing this year. It was iPad, or it's probably mobile, actually. I played it on iPad. But it's a brilliant kind of spin on Hitman Go, which came out last year, I think. But it's superbly atmospheric, turn-based, but properly hard as nails. But incredibly rewarding. Have you played again?
I haven't played at all, no.
Right. So the Go series, like the whole mantra with them, I think they're made in Eidos Montreal, that's what it's like. And they're... like, distill whatever it is about that franchise, strip it back, and distill it into kind of almost like a game, tabletop game. Like Hitman more so, because it actually looked like board game pieces. Whereas this, it's all about puzzles and, like, I also like how it brings back big monsters to Tomb Raider, which is kind of a bit lacking from Rise of the Tomb Raider.
Right.
There's basically a giant snake that pursues you
in Go, but it's kind of weaved all the way through. You sort of kind of see it right at the very beginning, and there's all this kind of stuff because there's basically shadows in the foreground, and you see all this kind of stuff that's happening, but you never quite know what's going on. But then you see the snake moving in the background, and it's right at the end that you get to fight it, but obviously in a very specific way because it's all turn based. But it just, like, some of the puzzles are so supremely hard, especially on the new DLC that's just come out.
Yeah,
Caves of Fire, I think it's called.
Is it free?
It's free. But I'm spending. Whereas the first game, I was rattling through it because it teaches you the kind of dynamics. But there's some new bad guys in this that respawn after four turns, and just trying to remember what kind of turn they're on. And I'm spending half an hour on each level.
That's cool.
It is cool, but at the same time, I'm like, just give me a glimmer of success here. And you're just, you know, when you've screwed it up because you can't make a wrong turn.
It's got a lovely art style as well. Oh, it's very vibrant block colors.
Yeah,
it sounds like it's this really smart way of doing like mobile games as well. Like,
I think so.
We had that all that stuff.
Play a regular Tomb Raider game.
Exactly. But it seems like they, even though they're still carrying on with like their big franchises, making cool versions of them is really good. Yeah. Not like Konami doing just like, get rid of everyone. We're just doing mobile now. Get rid of Kojima. That'd be good.
I want to see what they do in that Go series next, like Deus Ex Go or Final Fantasy or something. Yeah. Like, it's a really cool concept of like raiding your back catalog.
And you're right, like Square's kind of like
adapting it.
Catalog is extremely rich. So, even all the kind of old Final Fantasy Tactics games would, I know they were adapted for iOS, but create something that's built on iOS from the ground up would be my kind of thing. I'd love to see that.
Yeah. Okay, one of my favorites that I played and I really enjoyed it was Until Dawn. I think quite a lot of people enjoyed this.
I think this is the surprise hit of the year. Especially because it was delayed several times.
And I think, if you don't know what it is, it's kind of like a horror game, almost in the same vein as like Heavy Rain and stuff, where everything's sort of like choice-based, but you have to make choices like really, really quickly. But it's set over the course of like sort of like a stereotypical like teen horror movie type thing. But it's just really good. I started off, I kind of didn't know
that into it.
I wasn't that into it, no. And then something clicks with it, and you realize, because you're meeting all these different people that are doing all these different, you're just like, oh, this is really written really badly. But then actually, the more you get into it, you realize, oh, it's written like that on purpose.
Yeah.
Because then, but then you can influence what that person does. So like, you have like the jock, and he's being an arsehole.
Yeah.
But through his decision, through the decisions you choose to make with him, I mean, with him, I was like, I hate him so much, I want him to die.
Right.
But then you're like, actually, I'm making his decisions for him. Yeah. So I can make him make nice decisions and make him a better person.
Yeah.
Which is a really, really smart way of doing it. And yeah, like by the end, I was like, oh, I really like him. Like, I don't want him to die.
Yeah.
And the storyline's really good. Like, it goes off in like a really bonkers way towards the end, which I think is a massive mistake. But up until that point, yeah, I thought it was really, really, really good.
Also because it's like very structured. It's not an open world. I think it looks incredible.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, there's some bits where you're exploring like the snowy like mountainside. Nice. It looks incredible.
Mm. It's not quite, because like, when we first played it, we were kind of thinking it was going to be more like a party-ish game where you could like...
I thought it might have been like, yeah, like you stay up late and like the people die quickly. It's much more like slow paced than
that. Yeah, so I tried doing that. So I had some friends around and like two of them don't really play games, but like we were all doing it and like kind of like passing the pad and trying to like... But it's not really for that.
No, it's more like because it's like episodic. It's broken up.
Yeah.
You better playing it like an episode a night or something. I think.
But yeah, it's just like, because it's got like actual horror people behind writing it and things like that. Like, it really feels like
Stakeland.
Yeah, yeah. It really feels like a horror film, but good.
But also, you can control whether everyone survives or no one survives, right? Well, through your actions.
Mutations, yeah.
It's, through your actions,
like,
yeah.
I think that's, you know, it's not like point A to point B and you get the same experience every single time.
No,
it's
no,
like,
yeah,
you know, you can.
You can do it in so many different ways.
It's like, there's been times like, I haven't finished it, but I was with a girlfriend, and there's been times where something will happen, you go, although I would say like sometimes not clear what's the
absolutely
right thing to
not,
do.
Yeah.
So there's maybe not the game aspect, because you can pick up these items, like these totems, and they show you like a vision of the future, like what could potentially be dangerous.
Yeah.
But still, when you find that thing, I'm not sure on like, let's say you've got two choices.
Yeah.
It's not very clear which is the good one to make.
No, yeah. It's really strange.
But I don't mind that. I still like it regardless of that.
I was quite frustrated at the end because a decision that I made, they died in a way that I was like, why did they just die? Like, why was that how the thing that I made her do?
How would I supposed to know that?
Exactly. Why would that have made, like, the thing that happens after it makes that, it shouldn't have happened. It's like, why would she die in that way? That doesn't make any sense. So I was kind of frustrated by the end, but at the same time, it's good to see people die.
Is it? Like, you know, a decision that you made a while ago will impact
again,
there.
I'm not sure.
Is it literally you make that decision, they die straight away?
Well, this is the thing. So a couple of bits where it's kind of like Telltale stuff where you kind of feel like you're influencing like the relationship. But I didn't really get that from it.
Right.
There wasn't enough interaction between all the characters where I was, you know, a girl was being a dick to me, so I was being a dick to her there. That I didn't see that having a sort of thing further down the line, which with Telltale games now and again you get.
Not with
Game of Thrones though.
Yeah.
But yeah. But actually, yeah, Telltale games I really want to play is the Borderlands one, because apparently that's really, really good, and I haven't touched it at all. I need to do that. Al, the other, there's one game on both of our lists.
Yeah.
It's so a big one for you.
It is a big one for me. It's the game I've spent probably more time than any game in the last few years playing. Metal Gear Solid 5.
Yeah.
At long last, it came out. And for the most part, I absolutely loved it.
Yeah.
Like, you heard me in the office. It was my ideal Metal Gear game. Like, having that freedom and to kind of explore and play it in completely different ways. Like, I absolutely go the stealth way, but listening to kind of Dan Kilby, he kind of tries to do stealth, screws it up, and then just pulls out his rocket launcher and starts shooting.
You don't kill a single person, do you?
No. Like, I invested all of my kind of resource into developing tranquilizers and stunning stuff.
Right.
Only killing people when you have to. But that's the beauty of it. Like, there is a mission that says you've got to take out, eliminate this person, but you don't. You can
get them back,
stun them
and then, back.
You know, because that's quite early on.
It's
I think
quite early on.
Really
I was like,
on. Yeah.
I thought you just kill him.
Yeah. But then,
and he's a really good,
it's a really good person to have on your team. And, and that's, I think, as a tech demo, it is just absolutely mind-boggling.
Mm.
The only problem with it is that it kind of really runs out of steam at the end. It needs to be at least a third shorter.
Right, okay.
Too many missions set in the same location.
Oh, yeah, like, definitely.
The world is vast. But really, you only spend any amount of time in a number of kind of locations, which you get to know really, really well. And I'm
definitely,
like,
yeah.
like side missions. I really don't want to go back into that prison and do that because I feel like I've done that six times already.
Oh, they should have tightened security by now.
Exactly.
I've been here seven times.
But also, that is clever because as the game goes on, you know, they start wearing more helmets if you do lots of headshots. They're wearing lots of body armor.
To your play style.
And body armor on the arms and legs because
if
you can't shoot them there, you shoot them on the legs. It takes longer for the trank to kind of work. And then night vision is the other thing because why would you do any mission in the middle of the day?
Yeah.
Because you're easily visible and...
I always think that.
I don't think I did. And not unless I had to.
Yeah. It's really strange. Like, the thing I really like about it is you do have these just crazy moments by yourself where something happens and you're like, what's happening to me right now is the only time this will ever happen. Because it's just like, there's so many different things, like variables and that, and you just think, that's just brilliant.
It's a brilliant playground. Like, it's almost like the apex of what he's tried to do over so many years.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, the thing that he was known for a long time.
Yeah.
People maybe weren't big fans of the game was like the huge cut sequences.
Yeah. Mm.
And this is more like, I just want to give you the ultimate playground.
Yeah.
That's the thing that I think that was one of the failings, I think. I didn't think there was enough of Kojima in it. Like, it's a really cool game and it's really brilliant to play, which is something like Metal Gear Solid 4 was the first game that I got on my PS3. And I was like working nights at the time, so it'd be like I'd come home and be like, right, I'll do a quick hour on Metal Gear, and just like what? And just like then you're like when you introduce it like Raiden, and you're just like, shit, he's really good. And you're like, I want to be him. Yeah. Like I'm boring. This is rubbish.
Play Metal Gear 2 then.
Yeah, exactly. But then with this, he gives you that like you know fun thing, and you can you can play it for an hour and do like a mission in an hour and things like that. But I think I really did miss having like storyline because it starts off that like the beginning bit in the I was like this is awesome like all the crazy stuff going on and I was like I wanted more of that
I completely agree and like I say it felt like it was stretched a bit thin and well, I'm right at the end. But it's not obvious that I'm right at the end, and
I know you mean you should feel like you're coming to it.
I feel a bit unsatisfied.
Yeah,
which is a shame.
Ever since I was a little kid, I always wanted a dog. I really wanted a dog, and my mum and dad wouldn't let me have a dog because it was cruel to leave it at home all day.
It's not.
It gave me a dog. It gave me a dog that I love.
I feel
Did
like
you ever want a female sniper.
Well, not when I was a little kid.
Okay. I feel. Well, now you do.
I feel like. That excuse the parents give their kid, oh, it's cruel to leave it at home, is bollocks. I don't think that's true.
Again, tell me what you really think.
I think it is.
It is. But you can't leave a dog at home all day on its own.
No, well, have you got snacks and stuff for it?
No, they get separation anxiety. They're meant to be with people.
No, sit the raging one for it. It's fine.
No.
I think it depends on the dog. I think it's all right.
Why is it gonna do shit?
They destroy your bit.
No, they get bored and they destroy the house.
So you leave the door open for it as well.
Well, yeah, if you've got an enclosed garden.
I think it's true.
Wow. You should never, ever have pets or children.
They'll be destructive. Neither. They'll just get bored.
You can leave kids at home by themselves as well.
Well, maybe when they're 16.
Get them like one of those like hamster water bottle things.
You can put collars on kids. but to get back to the point, Dee is brilliant.
He is awesome, yeah.
He's such a good, like, companion.
You don't need any other buddy.
No, you don't need anyone else. He's the best. He just finds everyone. Yeah. And then later on, you can take him out.
Like when you send him off and he gets shot up and then has to be kind of like airlifted out. Sad times.
Yeah, that's really sad.
And your bond with him goes down a little bit.
Oh, poor guy.
Dee.
Oh, but quiet. She.
just humming all the time.
Earache, love.
And then you're like, can you shoot them? Oh, no, because you've just disappeared. Thanks.
GBH to the ears.
Right, Krupa, what's your last game on your list?
My last game is a game I reviewed called Soma. This is from the people who made Amnesia, the first Amnesia game. And it is, imagine Blade Runner meets Bioshock. I think that's a good way of pitching it.
Okay.
So you're set in a underwater facility in the future.
Right.
And again, it's one of the games I don't really go on too much about the details because
it's really
hard. It's a story-driven game.
Yeah.
It's not quite everybody's gone to the rapture, but it's a little bit like that. It's, you know, it's not a walking simulator. There are puzzles to solve. And there's buttons to press, and there's some monsters to avoid. So a little bit Alien Isolation kind of, you know, obviously Amnesia did that beforehand.
Yeah.
But like sneaking around corners, hiding behind desks, stuff like that. I think that stuff where you're hiding from the monsters is kind of the weakest stuff in the game because I don't know how to hide from them effectively. It's a bit like what it was like in Alien Isolation. It's like, I'm doing everything I can think of to
and
avoid
still getting
this,
me, yeah,
and it's
yeah,
still
yeah,
finding me.
Yeah.
I think I'm, and then I just got to a point where I was running through places just to get yeah, to the next checkpoint.
Yeah.
But the story stuff is really interesting. And it's to do with, you know, it's like a Philip K. Dick, you know, it's an inspiration for it. It's
yeah,
like the difference between your mind and your body and the soul and what it means to be human.
Yeah.
And because it's a first-person game, it really takes great advantage of that perspective and putting you in the eyes of someone else.
Yeah.
That I can't think of, you know, nothing else can do that.
Yeah.
Fiction, like, can do that a bit because when you read, like, I did this.
Yeah.
So you identify a bit like that. But game, this takes it to another level.
Yeah.
Mm. And it's got one of the best endings of any game I've played.
Ooh.
Like, it's got a really fantastic ending.
That's brilliant.
That probably makes me think the overall game's much better. But like, right, it's like,
that's the thing you
they've
remember,
got the core idea throughout it is great. Yeah. It's really worth playing. It's on PS4 as well.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. Right, there's some big games, right, that came out this year that didn't make our lists.
Yeah. So, that, yeah, it's worth specifying. That's our personal
That's
favorite,
our personal favourites, yeah.
And
yeah,
I have no doubt that we will get absolutely destroyed in the comments yeah, for not including some of the other big releases that came
like
out this year.
Like Fallout 4, Witcher 3, Mad Max, Batman Arkham Knight, Assassin's Creed Syndicate, Just Cause 3, Dying Light. What do all those have in common? They're all shite now.
They didn't make our list.
No, they're all massive, like they're all
loads
ridiculously
of big games,
massive.
Yep.
Like I think,
well, especially Fallout and Witcher.
Yeah. Like the worlds are too big, man.
It just sounds like you're gonna just have a little cry after that.
The world's too big.
It's just I don't understand how people play all these games or have time to play all of them.
Yeah.
Well, it's hard to like play. You can't play everything. People
it's
who said they play
and
everything
we don't have time
is
to do
like.
It.
Well, you're either lying or you do nothing else.
Yeah. There's a couple of people, actually, like, I won't say names or anything like that, but it was a little tip that I picked up from you. Like, I've started some of the games people that I follow, looking at what they tweet about and things like that, about playing a game, then going to look at, I'm friends with them on, like, PSN, looking at how many hours they've actually played on that game. There was someone recently, and I'm not fucking say who it is, who reviewed Star Wars Battlefront for quite a reputable place and was like, oh, it's just, it's boring as shit. I checked his PSN. He played it for 3 hours. He played 15 matches, like, and then was like, and then that's not even everything. And was like, and also he talked about.
You are the real video game journalist.
He talked about like, oh, it takes this. Wow. It takes this amount of time to unlock the rocket pack. Yeah, but you've made that up because you didn't play it for that amount of time.
No, because it does take quite a long time to get yeah, the jetpack.
Because there's other things as well. Like I think I could play. You know, I could play like 13 hours of Battlefront and be like, okay, I'm done with that. Like I think. It was really good. I'll still go back to it now and again, like yeah, when they release DLC and stuff. Yeah. It's good like that. And I think there is an argument that, like, you didn't put stuff in your list because you hadn't finished them.
Yeah.
Which I think is fair enough.
I think that's also an old mentality.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's the mentality you take over from, like, reading books, watching films.
Yeah.
You get to the end, but, like, sometimes, like, TV shows, like, these are almost, like, different. Like,
yeah.
If it's not sustaining it, like, you could force yourself to get through it to the end, but you're just not going to enjoy it.
Yeah.
And I can sample a game and have a good time in it and not get to it. I've probably played 10, 15 hours of Fallout 4.
Which is a long time.
I played
time.
8 hours of Witcher, and, like, I did a lot of coverage on The Witcher for IGN.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, that's the point where you're so saturated with it.
Yeah.
And it comes out and, like, just move on to other stuff.
Man, when we were, so for The Witcher, when we went over to Poland, is it Poland?
Yeah.
And we played the first 7 hours, was it? Like, I was really enjoying it, but then I was also, by the seventh hour, I was like, okay, I probably wouldn't play 7 hours straight of something. Well, but then I got to that, and I was just like, I had this realization, I was like, I'm never fucking doing this 7 hours again.
Yeah, you have
yeah,
to.
Like,
yeah.
And I was just like,
yeah,
I'm never going
to
play Witcher.
I didn't want to do that 7 hours again.
Because yeah, it was all right.
Yeah. There's been loads yeah, of games that I've yeah, had that with, especially around the launch of PS4.
Mm.
Like, what's the shooter called? The futuristic shooter?
It is Killzone.
Killzone.
Yeah.
I must have played the first three or four hours of that game about 6 times different events. And I was like, and it wasn't that great. It's very average, but it's just, I cannot play any more of that.
No.
But it is true. Like, you know, sampling games early does kind of put you off that.
I think you've got to be smart with it. I think Until Dawn, the preview that we did of Until Dawn, where we went along and played a very small part, it was all, and then when you actually, when that bit's in the game, it's a bit different as well.
Yeah.
I think that's what you've got to do.
It's a sliver.
Not well, take 7 hours or something.
But looking through this list, Arkham Knight, I really enjoyed Arkham Knight.
It was really good.
But there's nothing about that game that has made it stick in my mind.
Yeah. No. I feel like Arkham Asylum was such a big thing, and City was as well. Like, the fact they made this great Batman game.
Yeah.
Where no one had high expectations. Obviously, like, tremendous expectations going into this one. It's been delayed. Expectations ramp up even more.
Yeah.
And it's a really good game.
Yeah.
But I don't think none of us really discuss it much afterwards.
Like, mechanically, it was absolutely spot on. You know, they listened to the criticisms that were with City and, you know, gliding around the whole of the kind of Arkham felt brilliant.
It's the same thing with Mad Max as well.
Yeah, the Batmobile was, we should flag that, like, slightly controversial. A lot of people didn't like those segments.
Yeah, I didn't mind it. But like, some of the kind of missions, similar thing, like you'd go in, you look at the map and it's like, I've got to do missions where I've got to take out the drone tanks and that.
Also, like, I don't want to do that. Don't make me 100% a game to get the ending.
Oh, I know, yeah.
Don't make me do that because I'm just going to watch it on YouTube.
Like, Metal Gear does a similar thing.
Yeah, it's just because I feel like...
You have to kind of jump through hoops to get...
No, I did a lot of side mission stuff, but it's just like, I don't want to do every single
word. 100% is... In my eyes, unacceptable. I'm never going to have the time to do that. And I did exactly what you said. I watched it on YouTube.
Yeah. Yeah. It's fine. Okay. I just wanted to know then. Because I was like, if I do everything, I'm not going to see that for another 2 weeks.
Yeah.
I just wanted to know then.
Yeah.
It's the same with Assassin's Creed Syndicate. That's what you reviewed, that. You really like that.
I think Assassin's Creed Syndicate is a really good game. You know, that franchise is a huge franchise. And it blows hot and cold.
Yeah.
It's, I think we all agree, what a cool concept for a video game series.
Yeah.
And I think recently they've realised that nobody cares about the overarching narrative. Obviously, sorry, I know people, there'll be some people who really like Assassins.
Some people really do.
Read the comics, read the books, fine. But I do think those, to the wider public, people want to like run around a cool historical location, bump into Charles Dickens, Charles Darwin, and do missions. And that's what this game does.
Yeah.
The stuff that's like the modern day Templar stuff, the game almost makes fun of.
Yeah.
Like, the brother and sister, the sister wants to be a really devout assassin.
Yeah.
And the brother's like,
I just want,
like, should we, like, save London?
Yeah.
And that's what the game is. And, you know, I think it's a particularly cool period of history.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a really fun game.
Yeah, it's really good, but too big. There's some other stuff on the list as well. Super Mario Maker and Splatoon. We haven't put any Nintendo games on our list.
Well, the problem I have with Mario Maker is the same problem I have with Little Big Planet, is that I'm not a game designer.
Yeah.
And so I want game designers to design my levels.
But people have made some really good ones, though.
Yeah, I don't want to. It's not for me. It's not for me.
Like, in fairness, with Mario Maker, I like watching videos of people playing Super Mario Maker more than I like playing it.
Right.
Like, I like watching videos of people of, like, look how hard this level is.
But
that
was the other thing. It just became that. It wasn't a celebration of creating, like, clever levels. It was just like, look how hard this
some
is.
Some are good.
Everything I've seen, I know you mean, yeah.
One of my favourite memories of this year was, it was the evening of E3 on Sunday before Bethesda's conference. And in the afternoon, Nintendo were doing the World Championships.
Yeah.
And they had a section for the world's best Mario player.
Yeah.
And they constructed levels. And the players were seeing them sight unseen.
Yeah.
Made in Mario Maker.
Yeah.
Like, insane. Like, again.
Bonkers, yeah.
Like, possible, but bonkers stuff.
Yeah.
And we were watching them, like, everyone from IGN in this room watching it. And people were just getting so invested, like, screaming when this guy was like... Obviously, this dude was playing it on another level. Like, he was one with the Matrix.
Yeah.
But it was so impressive to see him play it.
Yeah.
One of my New Year's resolutions is to get into Splatoon. Because I've got people who I really like who are really into it. And I never... It just passed me by completely. Yeah. And I really want to have
mine on it. It's got loads better since the initial launch as well. Yeah. Like, it's had so much kind of, you know, tweaks and improvements. Yeah. And, like, free stuff added to it.
It feels like that's the kind of game that we would like to play.
Yeah.
We get some more Rory stories out of... Splatoon, I think. What else? Has anyone got... This is the thing. What's your worst game of 2015? I know what mine is, if you want some time to think.
Yeah,
mine is NBA 2K16, which I think is borderline unplayable.
Why?
Like, so there's this big thing about Spike Lee doing the storyline for it.
Yep.
So I was really excited because I like the NBA games, and I think, like, 2K's sports games are always really, really good. So I was really excited about this. And... So Spike Lee's doing the storyline for us. You think it's going to be... I don't know if any of you played Fight Night Round 2. I think it's round two. But like the storyline basically for that is like you start off. It's an actual storyline to the entire thing.
Right.
Like you go to prison, and then you basically have to work your way out of prison
by punching people.
So you basically you start off with prison fights, yeah, and then you work your way up, and it's a cool storyline. Like it's quite contrived, but like it's I don't know. It was putting something like that onto a sports game.
Yeah.
Always makes me more interested in it, I think. And I really like that. So that's why I was excited about NBA 2K16. I thought Spike Lee write in this storyline. What it is a video game that's written by someone who doesn't even know what a video game is.
Right.
So it starts off, the storyline starts, I don't care about spoilers. But if you bought it, it's big enough spoilers, it's bollocks. But it's like, it starts off with people in their mocap suits.
Yeah.
Talking on a sofa, and I was like, is this a loading thing? I don't know what this is. I thought maybe they're throwing like some behind the scenes stuff for the loading. I thought that's quite smart. And then Spike Lee yell cut, and he walks into the shot and he's like, hey, I'm Spike Lee, I've done this game. And then he just clicks his fingers and then he's in a video game and he's like, I've done a video game. And I was like, what is this? Who is this for? I was like, I thought Spike Lee, you know, has made some like really gritty films. I thought it's gonna be like that. No, it was bollocks. It was like he's written like this like sort of kid's story. Maybe it gets a little bit more gritty as it goes on, but the dialogue was awful. But then also, you obviously design your player.
Yeah.
So, but I didn't know I was meant to be designing a high school student. So I'm designing this player, and I was like, yeah, I'll make him. You know,
it's a bit like your GTA character.
What?
A little bit out there.
Like old man.
Well, like Richard. Not Richard Hammond. That's the other one.
Richard John Hammond. Sorry. John Hammond, yes. The hamster.
You love Richard Hammond.
Not a hamster. He's not a hamster.
Well, that's the weird thing about when we play GTA Heist. You've all made people look like you. I've made someone who looks like David Attenborough. Fucking hell. John Hammond from Jurassic Park.
Richard Attenborough.
Yeah. Dickie. Richard Attenborough, yeah. But yeah, and then so I made my character in NBA 2K16, but he's a giant. So he's playing against kids in a high school thing.
I can see why in a character creation for a basketball game you made him big.
Exactly, yeah.
I can see why. That's massive. Fine. That's
slam dunk.
They should have anticipated that.
It's weird to look at as well.
Also, you know what I like with, I think it is that one. It's a lot of the 2K sports games. The scan your face in.
Oh, and
it looks like the face is like a transfer that's slipped down. Yeah. Or it's like on a hot day. It looks like the Marge t-shirt.
Yeah, it does look like that. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, it's like I played it for a bit. And then I was like, I'm not playing this anymore.
Yeah.
This is shit.
So I wouldn't say it's the worst game I've played all year, but disappointing, Just Cause 3.
Okay.
Because I love Just Cause 1 and 2, and looking at all the videos and all the kind of cool stuff you can do, it's like, that's great.
Mm.
But the problem is, I think the fundamental kind of mechanics that that game is built on are just broken. Okay. Obviously, you know, it's been widely reported how kind of buggy it is.
Yeah.
But just driving a car... it's like driving a brick, like no word, especially coming from a game like GTA, where every car feels refined and different, and it's just kind of next level. And we were talking about it in the office, and you know, one of the things came up was like, oh, it's because they don't want you to drive the car; they want you to kind of, you know, like fly through the air with your kind of grappling hook. It's like, well, still, that's not an excuse.
That's
you
not
should
an excuse.
Still have good mechanics, because otherwise, don't have cars in there.
Definitely,
if you don't want me to drive a car and you don't want me to drive it well, don't do that. And so I played it, not for that long, but unfortunately, it just did not impress me.
Yeah.
And for all the kind of cool stuff that I'm sure it will serve up later, it's like, well, the opening impression was like, nah.
I haven't touched that. Cooper, do you have a worst game?
Most disappointing game.
Okay.
Evolve.
Yeah. This year. Holy shit.
Got to move back. Yeah. And that's partly why. I think there was a period of time where I was super pumped.
Yeah.
That sounds so American. I was really very excited.
Excited.
I was very excited to play Evolve.
Mm.
And it just missed the window for me. Like, I played it a few times at events and had the best time with everyone. When it all set up, it was such a fun game, such a cool concept. Space Jurassic Lost World, basically.
Mm. Yeah.
Hunting this big monster, communication, everyone, different abilities. Yeah.
Maybe we should try it again. Now that we've got like the five stars, maybe we should have a go.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
And so I still think the game, you know, our review was really positive. I think we gave it 9.
Mm.
Like, by and large, like, people think it's a good game. It just, like, missed it didn't catch the imagination. Yeah, no. And also partly the way that it was priced up and divided,
like,
and
bonkers,
the weird pricing structure. If you buy this, it's like, what am I buying here?
Yeah.
But I also feel like...
like, if that was a PS Plus... imagine if it was released as a free PS Plus game for the first month.
Yeah.
And then you could buy loads of new guys.
Yeah.
But I think that's partly the thing. Like, when we played it at some of the early events, it's kind of, this is great. But I was thinking there was going to be something more to it.
And there wasn't.
And there wasn't.
Yeah. And that was kind of it. And also, like, a lot of the worlds, like, look very similar. Yeah. All very dark. Yeah. I thought there's going to be more, like, variety. Almost like a Left 4 Dead, where there are those story modes in it, essentially, where you can do several games. Not story mode, but you know what I mean? Like, a sequence of missions.
Yeah.
I just thought it would be more varied. Like, you'd be going to wildly different locations. Yeah. And
Maybe we should give it another go.
We should give it another go.
Yeah.
We'll stick that in the give it another go category. But yeah, that's it. That's the best and worst of 2015. I'm sure we've missed out some of your favourites, so let us know in the comments below.
Well, there'll also be IGN's best of 2015 up on the site over Christmas, and you can nominate your own within that as well.
Yeah. So yeah, thank you very much, and we'll see you on the next podcast.
Adios.